Hi, this is Mr. Conti, and in this video we're going to be covering topics in work and energy. The first topic is the relationship between work and energy, which is stated within the work and energy theorem. And basically, work is defined as whenever a force is responsible for causing a change in the system, and the types of changes that we're looking for are changes in motion. So anytime an object gains or loses speed, that must be due to a force, which we recognize from Newton's second law. But when that happens, we say that that force has done work. For a force to do work, it requires energy. So energy is the ability for a force to do work. When a force does positive work on your system, that adds energy to your system. And when a force does negative work, it takes energy away. So a system can be defined in any way you'd like, as long as you account for all the interactions within the system. So internal forces live inside the system, external forces live outside the system. So anytime you have an external force that does positive work to your system, that increases the energy of your system. If a force does negative work, then that decreases the energy in your system. Now, it may be that you have objects that are exerting forces on each other inside the system. So you could have two objects that exert forces on each other, and in this case it takes energy to do work, but the system experiences no net gain or loss in energy. So when forces do work within a system, there's no change in energy, and therefore all the energy must be accounted for. And what you find is that energy begins to change form within your system. So if the motion can be transformed into other forms of motion. For instance, one object can pass on its motion to another object in your system through a collision. If an object compresses a spring, the spring will store that energy. So although maybe an object that collides with a spring might slow down as it compresses the spring and eventually come to a stop, and the motion appears to be gone, the energy isn't. It's stored within the spring. And so that's what makes the spring force, which at that point was doing negative work on the object, that's what makes the spring force a conservative force, because once the spring force has the opportunity to do positive work, it will return all that energy back to the object. But at no point in time, if all of that action was going on inside the system, then there's no net gain or loss in energy. But when you have external forces doing work, then you might have an overall net gain or loss in energy. So here we have a simple system. The system consists of a block on a frictionless surface, and there is a force that is pulling the block from an initial position to some final position to the right. So in the case of this example, it would be your best option to say that the block is the system, and that whatever's exerting the force pulling the block is an external force. Because then what we can say is that whatever the force is doing to the block, it's transferring energy into the system as it does positive work. It's doing positive work because the force is in the same direction as the motion, and so it's helping to increase the amount of motion that that block has. So the final velocity will be greater than the initial velocity. And so we could just talk about how much energy is being transferred into the system by that force. If we had chose to make that force part of our system, then we have to account for how much energy that object originally had, and we don't have enough information to clarify that. So, because you would have to then state how much energy is in the system. You can't say it's zero, because in order for that object who is pulling this mass, for it to exert that force, it must have energy. And so it would be a valid question to ask how much energy does it have, but if we don't have that information, it would be hard to move forward. So we're going to take this as an external force. And so the first question you might ask is how much work is being done by that force. And so we define work as that force times the distance. And so the distance here is from x initial to x final. That is the distance. Which is the same thing as delta x. And this is true because this force is constant and one-dimensional. Now, if I want to know how much energy has been transferred into the system, the work being done by that force equals the change in energy of that system. So that means whatever, so we don't know, you have to know how much energy it started with, and if you know how much energy you started with, you know how much energy you end with, because this is E final minus E initial. So E final equals whatever E initial was plus the work done by that force. Well, let's ask the question now, how fast could that force actually get the block to move after it travels that distance? Well, because this is a constant force, that means it's constant acceleration. So that means I can do a known unknown table for this situation. And so I'm assuming that I have this V initial, and I have the force and the mass of the block. So acceleration just equals divided by the mass. So I do have the acceleration, and I know the distance is delta x, and I'm looking for V final. And so that is the equation that doesn't have t in it. And so that would get us v final squared equals v initial squared plus 2a delta x. But a is f over m. And in this equation, I see an F times a delta X. Well, that's just the work that's being done by that force. So I can actually start to arrange this a little bit to solve for that work term. So I want to get rid of everything besides F and times delta X. So first thing I'll do is subtract V initial onto both sides, and I'm going to flip the equation around. So V final squared minus V initial squared, and that equals 2F delta X over M. And then I am going to multiply both sides by M and divide both sides by 2. And what I get is that F times delta X equals 1/2 M, the quantity V final squared minus V initial squared. And this, by definition, is how we define what we call the change in kinetic energy. So this is work that's being done purely to change the motion of that block. So there's nothing else that force is doing. None of that energy is being stored anywhere. 100% of that energy is being changed into motion. So as the force has done the work to carry it this distance, it has increased the total energy of the system to increase the speed of the object. And what we get on this side, if I spread the terms out, I have 1/2 mv final squared minus 1/2 mv initial squared. And so this term here represents my E final, and this one here represents my E initial, and therefore I have the change in energy of my system. So this is the change in kinetic energy. So if you know that the force in your system is only causing a change in motion, then all the energy is going to be a change in kinetic energy. And so you can also try to make sure to identify that with pie charts that we did last year, bar graphs. I'll get into that momentarily, but it's just important for us to see that we can always figure out how fast an object goes if we know how fast it was to start with. We can calculate its initial kinetic energy, and then the work that's being done by that force to carry it that certain distance, if we add those two terms together, we get the final kinetic energy, which will tell us the speed of the object later. So that's this strategy right here. So this term depends on the initial velocity of the system. This is the how much the force carries the object over that distance, and then this term will tell us the final velocity of our object. So we're going to add kinetic energy to a list of the different forms of energy that you're expected to know. Remember, both work and energy are both scalar quantities. So mass is obviously a scalar, but this V here just represents the speed. It's not the velocity. It is just the magnitude of the velocity squared. So that term does not depend on direction. All right, let's revisit the force versus displacement graphs and the difference between conservative and non-conservative forces. So I have two systems set up here. The first system is lifting a block to a certain height, and the second system consists of a block on a spring which is sitting on a frictionless surface. So if we start with the system on the left, if I take this block and I start to lift it up, that is that I apply a force. So if we define the block as our system, I am an external force that comes into the system. I have energy, and when I start to do positive work on this block, then I will give the block energy, and we would expect that force, according to the work energy theorem, that force would cause the object to change its motion. Now let's just say I would have to exert enough force to overcome gravity to get it to accelerate in the first place. So gravity is right now acting on this block. I should mention that the system here anytime we start talking about gravity is the block Earth system. So the Earth is considered to be inside our system, and the abstract thing that you're thinking about is when we close our system with our circle, what gravity, the entire Earth doesn't fit inside that circle, but what is there is the Earth's gravitational field. So we would say that the Earth's gravitational field is inside of our system, and so we still do feel a pull by gravity this way. But now I'm going to start to pull the block upward by a certain F applied, and that's going to get my object to go up. Now, if gravity wasn't there, then all of the force that I exert doing positive work would cause the block to accelerate. But because gravity is there, as I do positive work, gravity does negative work. So if we consider the Earth as part of our system, then the energy that is taken out of the block by the Earth's pull must still be part of the block Earth system. So the total energy must still be conserved. So whereas the motion might not change, so for instance, if I just start lifting it at constant velocity so that these two forces balance out, then the total energy must still be there even if I don't see any change in the motion. So here I'm doing work and I'm not getting any change in speed. That's because the positive work that I'm doing is being canceled out by the negative work that gravity is doing. So the way we would write that is that the positive work that I'm doing, it's F applied, plus the negative work that's being done by gravity is resulting in no net change in the system, which also means that there's no net change in the energy of the system. So all the energy that I put in that should appear as motion isn't there, so it must be in some other form. So the amount of energy that I've put into the system is not in the form of kinetic, but in the form of gravitational potential energy. And so if I got rid of the work done by gravity, then I would have the total kinetic energy that I would have stored in that system. So the work that was done by that force would equal the kinetic energy in my system. But because of gravity, all of that energy now is turned into the amount of, let me go back and use the other convention here, EK for kinetic energy. Since I'm not seeing any of that energy, then that must mean that this is also equal to the amount of gravitational potential energy that I've stored in my system. So the work that I've done led to me storing this much gravitational potential energy in the system. But from this statement here, it shows that the I've changed this a little bit. I want to show that I'm adding the total work, because what this term actually is the net work being done is zero, or the sum of all the work is being equal to zero. And the only way that that's true is if WFA equals negative WFG. And that's true. It's because this term is negative, whatever this term is, and so the negatives will cancel and you get the same value. So going back down here, since F, the work done by the applied force, equals negative the work done by gravity, then the gravitational potential energy equals negative the work done by gravity. And you'll see this relationship again in the next unit, where we focus a little bit more time on potential energy. But the relationship between work and energy, work and potential energy, is a negative relationship. The work and kinetic energy is a positive relationship. The work done by a force should cause there to be an increase in kinetic energy. But if it's a conservative force, it's doing negative work, then it will increase the total potential energy within the system. Now, how much potential energy does it store? That comes, again, from this graph. If we were to go, these two forces are balanced. One's positive and one's negative. So either way, if I do by graph, this is the applied force, or if I were to graph FFG, maybe a little bit lower, should be the same distance. So I could either find the area between FA and the horizontal axis, or so it's just the positive area, or I find the negative area down below, which tells me it's doing negative work, and I put a minus sign out front of there. Right, that's what this is telling us. So I can find the total gravitational potential energy by finding the work done by that force, which is the area under your graph, which would just be this block right here. Or I can find the gravitational potential energy by finding the negative work done by the force of gravity. Well, the force of gravity does negative work as I lift, and therefore the negative here comes from this negative over here. And so you end up getting the same number either way, is what that is supposed to show. So the amount of work done to store that energy, which comes from the area so let's say the work done by FG equals negative the area of our block, our rectangle. So I gotta go down FG n over whatever delta y is. And so delta y from y initial, which is 0, to y final, which is h, is minus fg times h, which is minus, let's get rid of the minuses now, mg h from fg. And so that's something now we can add to our list, eg equals mgh, and the second system is the block on the spring. And so when the block was here at the equilibrium position, I exerted a force to the right and tried to move it with a constant speed. So in order to do that, I would have had to earlier on exert smaller forces to cancel out the small spring force that's there, and then later on I would have to increase the amount of force to keep it going at constant speed. And like now, if I wanted to hold this in place at this point here, the spring force is now balanced with the force that I'm applying. So what that would show is I'm doing positive work to move the block to the right, the spring force is doing negative work to try to act against me. And we learn through Hooke's law that the force that I apply is linear, just as the spring force against me is linear. And so that's why the equation for Fs is minus kx, and therefore the applied force for me to maintain constant motion or to keep the block held at rest at each position would be just kx, where x is defined as the distance away from x equals 0, the equilibrium points. So you don't have to write the deltas. So again, if you want to find the potential energy for this system, you either find the positive area of this triangle or the negative area of this negative triangle. Either way, you'll get the same answer. So come down here, say the work done by the spring force is equal to negative 1/2 base times height, negative because that's just part of the definition. Okay, so the work done, the potential energy is negative the work done by the conservative force, or the work done by the conservative force is equal to negative the increase in potential energy. So it's minus 1/2 base times height. The height is the minus kx, and the base is x. The negatives cancel. You get the work done by the spring is 1/2 kx squared. And so that equals the energy stored by the spring, which is what we call the elastic potential energy. And so we'll add that to our list now. The only other form of energy that we need to talk about is just any energy lost when non-conservative forces act on our system. So we've covered gravity and the ideal spring, the Hookean spring specifically. But when non-conservative forces like friction and air drag, or what would be called non-ideal springs, when they act on our system, they take energy away. So, for instance, if the spring does not return back to its normal length after being stretched, that's non-ideal, and therefore it will, it won't return all the energy back to the system. It won't have the strength that it had initially, and so it won't be able to exert the force on our object like it could before. It also, when you start messing around with springs, if you move them around, that causes a lot of friction between the within the metal, and so that can heat the metal up, and that's all energy being lost, and that can also permanently deform the spring. So let's take a case with friction. So here we have a block that has some initial velocity and is forced to come to a stop because there is friction in the surface. So if we consider the surface to be part of our system, then all the energy must be accounted for. But because friction is not conservative, it will not be able to produce a force later on. Once the block comes to a stop, the friction is gone, and so it has not, there's no energy left that the system can use to give that motion back. And that ultimately is because the surface has used it up in the random vibrations within the surface itself, also heating up the air, the vibrations of the molecules in the air from the vibrations within the surface. So we could account for it within our system, but it, because friction's non-conservative, it's no longer usable. So if we want to figure out how much energy was lost, all we need to do is figure out how much energy we started with. So the first thing we can do is say that the initial energy of the system was Ek, which is 1/2 m the initial squared. That's the amount of energy that the block had to begin with. Now, the block no longer has any energy. In the form of kinetic energy, it comes to a stop. So the work energy theorem states that when forces do work, it changes the total energy of the system. So the work done by friction must ultimately change the total energy in the system. The total energy is E final minus E initial, and so that's 0 minus 1/2 mvi squared. And so the work done by friction is just minus 1/2 mvi squared. So it's negative, which means that friction is doing negative work, which is something that we would expect because friction is going to be opposite to the motion. But we could then say that this is another form of energy, which would account for the energy within our system. And so the total energy that we would store is minus this energy. Not store, but loss. So we lost, this negative means that we lost it, so the amount of energy that was lost is minus this quantity. And so that quantity is what we call EQ. So let's say we didn't know how far the block could go with that initial amount of energy. Well, we could also say that the work done by the friction is minus the force of friction times that displacement. Well, that has to equal minus EQ. And so you can say that the internal energy that is lost is equal to the work done by that non-conservative force, which is just that force. So I'm going to write NC for non-conservative times the displacement. And that I'm going to add to our previous list as well. So the energy lost via a non-conservative force is just the work done by that force. And this case, FNC is constant. So friction is constant, for instance, and so this equation would hold. If it's not constant, well, that's when the calculus comes into play. And that is something that we began talking about in class. And so I'd like to touch base on that as well in this video. So here is another force over displacement graph. And this one shows a varying force. This could be written as some force as a function of x to produce whatever kind of curve that is. And what we're interested in is to find the work done by that force. So the work done by that force is equal to the force over the displacement. That's only true if the force is constant. And so what we need to do instead now is this curve can only be considered constant on very, very small scales. So if I were to take a slice of this curve, then we look at the top, then that the closer that these two lines are together, the smaller that displacement, the closer that top is to being flat. And as we take the limit as that displacement approaches zero, we do in fact get a flat top there. And so we can consider that to be our rectangle, and therefore we can then use the work formula for constant forces. So the height of this, both of these sides, as this approaches zero, this displacement approaches zero, the height of both sides is just, either side should just be the value of the function, f at x. And then this width is the infinitesimally small delta x, which we call dx. And so the area of that sliver is dw. And so we had stated then that dw equals f at x times dx. And that is how much work is done within that little displacement. If I want to find the total work from x initial to x final, I have to integrate both sides. The left-hand side gets me the total work, because this is the sum of all the work is the total work. Whether you write W total or not, this is just, again, the sum of all the little bit of work that you're doing is the total work. And so on the left, on the right-hand side, we just also want to include the limits of integration, if you know them, which is from x initial to x final. Of that force is a function of x times dx. So let's do an example. All right, so here is a varying force. If I wanted to try to find the area under this curve, I'd be estimating without calculus, because that the top of that is, if it's curved, there's really no set formula for that. So I have to resort to calculus to figuring out what that area is. But essentially, if I want to find the work between these two positions, how much work does this force do to take an object from this initial position to this final position is the area under that curve. And so that is where we use this work formula. And so that is the integral from 2 meters to 5 meters of 4x squared dx. So again, for notation purposes, we usually bring the constants out front. And so with integrating a polynomial, you add 1 to the power and then divide by that power. So you get the 4 out front, and adding 1 to the power, you get x cubed, and then dividing by that power to divide by 3. So that's the integral. And then we have to still evaluate it from 2 to 5. And so you just simply plug in the numbers. You get 4 times 5 cubed over 3 minus 4 times 2 cubed over 3. If I did the math right, that looks like it is 156 Newton meters. Now, the amount of energy that that force is transferred into the system is 156 joules of energy. So if you know that that is the only force acting on your system, if that object was initially at rest, V initial was initially 0, and you knew that the mass of the object was 2 kilograms, and you were interested to know what the final velocity was, then what you can say is, now that I know what the how much work that force has done, the total work done equals the change in the energy of the system. So because the initial velocity is 0, and the only energy that I have to worry about is the kinetic energy, so that's 156 joules. And the kinetic energy formula is 1/2 mv squared. So to find the final velocity, I just do 2 times the work that was done by that force, divide it by the mass, and then square root it. So I get 2 times 156 Newton meters divided by 2 kilograms. A newton is a kilogram meter per second squared. So the kilogram here cancels with this kilogram here, and the meter and the meter square, time multiply by each other, and you get meter squared over second squared. So I get the square root of 156 meters squared over second squared, which is about 12.5 meters per second. So if the object was initially held at that 2 meter mark and moved to that 5 meter mark, then initially being held at rest, that force would have increased its velocity to 12.5 meters per second. Now, the other case you need to deal with is forces that are in more than one dimension. You have to use vector notation for them. So, if we have a system that does not, where the force isn't a varying force, so that means that these components are numbers. If these components are just numbers, then you just get a constant force. And this R is the distance from the origin. It's the position vector that represents the distance from the origin. So if this is your three-dimensional system, this vector points to this location here. That position can be written as a point x, y, z. So that's what these coordinates state, because it's measured from the origin. So we don't have to write the deltas. If you're not starting with your vector at the tail end of your vector at the origin, then you'd have to use the deltas. So if this force isn't varying, then we can just go back to using force times displacement. Except now we have two vectors to deal with. And so when you multiply two vectors, there's more than one way to multiply two vectors. There's the dot product, and then there's the cross product. We want to take these two vectors, and we realize that by the definition of work that we only want the force is only doing work when the force is causing that change in motion. So we want, if the object is moving to the right, then we want only the part of the force that's to the right. If it's moving a little bit to the right and a little bit up, then we want the components that are taking it a little bit to the right and a little bit up. So we favor the product that shows the projection of one vector onto another. So that's what it favors, so parallel vectors. So that would make sense, because you get the most work done when the force is being applied in the direction of motion. And so those two vectors would be parallel. And so that would suggest that we're looking at a dot product. And so the dot product between these two vectors can be written in two ways. First way is, if you knew the magnitude of the force, then you can multiply that by the magnitude of the displacement vector times the cosine of the angle between them. So you would only be able to figure out the work this way if you knew the angle between them and these two magnitudes. The magnitudes are easy. If you have either given them, or you can do Pythag, which in three dimensions is the square root of all the components squared. But It's not likely that if you have a three-dimensional system that you're going to be told the angle between them, because it's not the angle measured from an axis. It's the angle between the two vectors. So that is not something often that is given to you. That, however, may be something that you're asked to find. And if you thought about how hard that might be to do that geometrically, or to try to even draw something like that and represent it right, that becomes a challenging thing to start to draw in three dimensions. But if you had the force and the displacement in a vector notation, unit vector notation, then you could find the dot product the other way, which is simply multiplying the x components plus the y components plus the z components. So you get fx times x plus fy times y plus fz times z. So now, this will allow you to figure out the work done. But if now if you've already had all these terms, then that means you can find the magnitudes of F and R. So then you could work out what the angle between them. The angle between the two vectors is the inverse cosine of the dot product of those two vectors, which is this thing up here, divided by the magnitude of F times the magnitude of R. So that's a useful thing that we've practiced at the beginning of the year, to find the angles between vectors. That might be something that you're asked about, is what the angle is between the force and the displacement vector. It's possible. Now, what if the forces are varying? Well, then we have to bring in calculus. So we bring back the formula that the work is equal to the integral from your initial position to your final position, which now are these R initial and R final, of your force dotted into dr. So there we are combining the variable force equation for work and the multidimensional force equation for work. So we have the dot product, but now we also have the fact that we have to integrate all of from your initial position to your final position, the force times that tiny displacement, and you're summing all of those up. So what does this mean? Well, we have to, if we can assume, because now the dot product goes the same way, as you have this force is a vector, like the one up here. So this is a force as a function of R, because R just means this, is that it has x, y, and z components. But we'll put a restriction on what we can do right now, which is to say that the force can vary, but this term is only a function of x, this term is only a function of y, and this term is only a function of z. So instead of this being a number, this could be x squared. Instead of this being a number, this could be y cubed. Instead of this being a number, this could be, z plus 1. That's fine. If anything else would require a little bit more math than you're expected to do. And dr is similar to this, except we put d's in front of all these terms. So dr is just dx I hat plus dy j hat plus dz k hat. So this is actually three different integrals, because when you dot the two vectors together, you get a term in the three dimensions. So it is appropriate then to write the three integrals out like this. So the work done is equal to the integral, and you have your first term is in the x direction. So you have x initial to x final, f at x dx, plus your second integral, which is just the y direction information. That's f at y dy, plus the third integral, z initial to z final, f at z dz. And so the total work done is the sum of all three of these integrals. So let's try an example. So here's our problem. So we have an object, and this is the initial position vector, this is the final position vector, and this is the force that governs the motion. And so the question is, how much work does this force do on our object to get the object from its initial position to the final position? So we have three integrals that we need to write down. So we could choose to first write, if this was like a problem set, we could choose to first write this formula here and say that this is what we're doing, and this is what it breaks up into, and here's where we break up those integrals. So the work done, let's take our first integral, which is in the x direction. So the integral, the limits are from 2 to negative 10. 2 is initial, negative 10 is final. The force in the x direction, our x component, and I should actually write that up here. Not only is this force a function of x, but it's the x component of our force vector, and so on. So I'm taking then the first term, which is x squared dx, and that's our first integral. Second integral is an integral from 3 to 4, and the function is 3y cubed, so I'm going to put the 3 out front because it's a constant, and then I have a y cubed dy plus and then my last integral is from 2 to negative 2 and the function is 1 minus z dz. Alright, so now we just have to integrate each of these. Integral of x squared is x cubed divided by 3. And that we're going to be evaluating from 2 to negative 10. The integral of y cubed is y to the fourth over 4. But then we have to multiply that by 3. And that we're evaluating from 3 to 4. Now the integral of this, we have to integrate both of these terms. So the integral of 1 is, with respect to z, is z. And the integral of z is z squared over 2. And that we're evaluating from 2 to negative 2. And so our task now is to do the math. So we have, this is where, you know, you have to be careful, like this is an odd function, so when I take the cube, the negative doesn't go away. So you have to be careful of how you plug things in. Make sure you use parentheses where you can. So this is negative 10 cubed over 3 minus 2 cubed over 3 plus 3/4, 4 to the 4th minus 3/4, 3 to the 4th plus 2 minus negative 2 squared over 2 minus 2 minus 2 squared over 2. And we put that into our calculator and see. So I got about minus 209 newton meters. So let me know if I did my math wrong. The next topic, if you can take out your worksheet if you remember, there were 11 problems. Some of them we went over in class. The one I want to look at is number 8. So you can pause the video and grab your worksheet. Number 8 says work and velocity. A force acts on a 3-kilogram particle-like object in such a way that the position of the object as a function of time is given by that position-time function. Find the work done on the object for a certain period of time. So I give you the hint that, you know, thinking about the speeds. So I just want to have you guys think a little bit about the approaches to this problem and what might be the easiest way to do this problem. So you might jump and say, all right, well, I'm looking for the work, so let's just find how much work it does. So work equals, and you might think, okay, which formula do I use? Do I use force times displacement? Or do I use the integral of force times dx, for instance? And you would look here, and you have to ask yourself, is the force constant or is it varying? Well, what you're given isn't even a force. It's a position function. So you're told a position is a function of time. So how do you know whether or not from that, if the force is varying? Well, remember that fun equals ma. So if a force is constant, the acceleration is constant. If the acceleration is a number, the velocity, if we integrate, is linear. And if we integrate that, the position function is a quadratic. So the highest power of the position function, x as a function of time, should be a t squared. But this function has a t cubed in it, and therefore there is a changing acceleration with this. That means there's a changing force, and so the force is varying. So you would, in fact, need to use the integral from x initial to x final of the force times dx. So what we have is a position function. It's a function of time. What we need is a force function that's a function of x. So if we wanted to go this route, it would take some work. And I'm just going to give you a preview, and you could finish it if you'd like, but then I'm going to show you the other possibility. So what we could say is, I know my x is a function of time. It's 3t minus 4t squared plus t cubed. So I could take the derivative, dx by dt, that's the velocity, and that'll give us 3 minus 8t plus 3t squared. I could take the derivative again, and the change in velocity, which is the acceleration, and that gets me minus 8 plus 6t. Then I can find the force, which is fun equals ma, which means I take my 3 kilograms, and I just multiply that through, and I get minus 24 plus 18t. So this is F as a function of time. So I can't determine the work done unless I know how force changes with position. So what now I need to figure out is how is dx related to dt? How is that related to, let me put an equal sign here. Do we know any relationship between dx and dt? Well, I look over here and I find that I know that dx divided by dt equals the velocity. So dx must equal the velocity times dt. And so that's my way out, is I can use force as a function of time, but replace dx with the velocity times dt. And so now it takes this form, where w equals, instead of, we have the force function as a function of, time, multiplied by the velocity, which is also a function of time, dt. And this term, you're going to see a little bit later. I'm going to come back and define what that term actually means, the force times the velocity. But now if you look at what we have to do, we have to take this function, minus 24 plus 18t, and we have to multiply it by this function. Once we do that, then we have to integrate it and then evaluate it from 0, from your t initial to t final, which is 0 to 4. That takes some work, because you'd have to foil the, unless you could figure out some other tricks, there is some things you can do, but without a lot of integrating experience, I'm not going to go into that detail. What you would do if you wanted to try it out is you should foil these two things. So, and then you'll have a bunch of terms, and you integrate each term and evaluate them from 0 to 4, and you'll get your answer. And the answer is correct at the bottom of the page, is 528 joules. But what I want to show you is that we can bypass all of this by remembering that if, you know, we're looking at this situation, we're saying this, there's no other forces that we have to worry about doing work on this object. So all the work that's being done by this force is changing the kinetic energy of our object. So we can now say that the work done by this force, which is what we're looking for, is just the change in the energy of the system, which is the initial kinetic energy. Let me say final kinetic energy first. Final kinetic energy minus the initial kinetic energy. So that is 1/2 mv final squared minus 1/2 mv initial squared. The m's don't change. The mass doesn't change throughout the motion. So I'm going to factor out 1/2 m so that there's less math to do. And I get this. This is much more doable to find the work this way. All I really then have to do is determine this. This is the velocity evaluated at 4 seconds, and this is the velocity evaluated at 0 seconds. So I up here already have my velocity function. It's this one right here. So if I evaluate this function at 4 seconds and at 0 seconds and plug it in here, I have my answer. So at 0 seconds, for instance, t equals 0, I get v equals 3. So my v initial is 3 meters per second. If I do v final, and I plug in 4, what I get is 19. And so I get 1/2 the mass times 19 meters per second squared minus 3 meters per second squared, and that should equal 528 joules. And I did all that without needing to integrate and do all that extra algebra that wasn't necessary. So, there's always more than one way to look at a situation. So you have to think about all the different possibilities that exist there. I want to quickly show you, if I had carried this integral out algebraically, and by that I mean we had stated that dx equaled v times dt, and so that the work done is equal to the integral of the force times dx, but the force fun equals ma, so the force is ma, and dx is v dt. Well, I also know that acceleration is dv by dt, so the integral, this integral becomes the integral of the mass, and then for the acceleration I could put dv by dt times v dt. And there's a dt on top and a dt on the bottom, so they cancel. And now I have an integral of the mass, which is a constant, so I bring it out front, times v dv. So this is an integral of velocity. So I would need initial velocity and final velocity bounds. And I want to integrate velocity with respect to velocity. So what do I get? V is the variable, so it has a power 1 up here. So I increase the power by 1 and divide it by that power. So you get the power 2 divided by 2. And I evaluate that from V initial to V final. And would you look at what we get? We get this 2 can come out front as a half. And so I get a half MV final squared minus 1/2 MV initial squared. And so that's just the change in EK. So that's what the integral gets you. So if you could figure out the change in the kinetic energy without using the force and the velocity functions, just by evaluating the velocity and finding the values of the speed at those different times, then you can bypass all those steps there. If you remember this from last year, I still believe that this is a nice little tool to use. On the AP exam, you might not have a lot of time to write a lot of this stuff down. You have to be thinking about this in your head, but it's a nice little visual you can think of to help you write the equations down that you need to for conservation of energy. So remember our LOL setup. These are bar graphs that tell you the amount of energy in your system, and we label all the forms of energy, EK, EG, EEL, EQ. This is our storyboard, and that tells us how When there's work being done by external forces, we show that with arrows going in or out to show the amount that positive or negative work is being done. But if the work is being done inside by internal forces, then we're getting transfers of energy from one form to another. And then what we show on this side is how they've changed. Okay, so let's try an example. So here we have a situation where you have a spring and a block is moving with some speed towards the spring. And it eventually collides with the spring, compresses it, and comes to a stop. So if you think about everything that's going on, if at the very beginning you ask the question, what's the energy within the block spring system. So just put that right here. So our system is comprised of both the block and the spring. So the energy is either in the block or it's in the spring. So we ask, is there kinetic energy? Yes, because there's motion. Is there gravitational potential energy? No, because there's no initial height difference that we have to worry about. Is there any elastic potential energy? No, because the spring is not compressed or stretched. Is there any internal energy? No, because no non-conservative forces have acted on our block. So the only energy, the total energy of the system, is whatever EK is. Now, as long as there are no external forces or non-conservative forces, the velocity is going to be constant from here until it hits this platform on the spring. Then as it continues to move to the left, the spring force is going to exert a force resisting the motion, and so it will begin to do, there's an F on spring by block, which will compress the spring, and that force is doing positive work. So because the block pushing the spring is in the direction that the spring is being compressed, so that's doing positive work. So the block will be expending its energy as it does positive work, right? So the block is going to use this energy. It's got energy. The energy that it has is kinetic energy, so it's going to use that energy. And so it will begin to slow down. But at the same time, in our system, as an internal force, the spring is acting against the motion and is going to do negative work. When conservative forces do negative work, they act to add potential energy to the system. So even though the block is now losing out on energy and its motion is decreasing, the spring is acquiring that energy and pocketing it for later use. And so as long as it's conservative, 100% of that energy is being stored. And so we go from EK to EG. Sorry, EEL. And so 100%. 100% here, 100% here. So what that does for you when you make the bar graphs like this, it allows you to write a formula, because this suggests that the total kinetic energy at the beginning, if the energy is conserved, let me write this first. There's no net work, there's no change in energy, and so all the energy is conserved. That means initially EK plus EG plus EEL plus EQ all initial has to equal EK plus EG plus EEL plus EQ final. That's what this means. Because if the delta E equals zero, E final must equal E initial. And so in this particular example, the only thing I had to start with was EK, so none of this was necessary. And then final, all I had was EEL. So my formula reduces down to EK initial equals EEL final. And so, depending on what your knowns are, you could figure out certain unknowns, because the two formulas become 1/2 mv squared. That happens to be your initial velocity, and that equals 1/2 kx squared, where x is the amount of compression that it takes for that the block compresses it before it comes to a stop. So there are four variables in here: mass, speed, the spring constant, and the position of the amount of compression. So if you were given any three of those, you could figure out the fourth. If I told you the mass of the block, how fast it was going before, and I told you how strong the spring was and gave you the spring constant, you could figure out how much it was compressed. If I told you how much it compresses and you knew the initial information, then you could figure out how strong the spring is by finding the spring constant. If I told you what the spring constant was and how much it was compressed and what the mass was, then I could tell you, then you could be able to tell me, work backwards and figure out how fast the block must have been moving to strike that, to compress the spring that way. And so every problem that you can do where you know the energy must be conserved can be thought of in this way, where the total energy being done before, contained within the system before, and let me just go back a couple pages. So just remember, you're thinking, this is motion. You ask the question, is there motion? Then if the answer is yes, there's kinetic energy. Is there a change in height in the problem? If yes, there's gravitational potential energy. Is there a spring? If yes, if it's compressed or stretched, then you have EEL. Are there non-conservative forces? If so, you have to deal with EQ. The last topic in this unit is the quantity called power. And so power is a rate, just like velocity is the rate of change of position with respect to time. It's, rates are how things change with time. The power is the amount of work done over a period of time. So the average power is just the change in the work over the change in time. Work is in Newton meters. Time is in seconds. That could also be joules per second. But that is also the same as a watt. If you want to know the amount of work done over time, if there's work done that's changing over time, so you want to know what the instantaneous rate of change of work. Because this is only going to be an average because you're picking two points. You're taking work, the work at one moment, and then the work at another moment, and you're finding the average. But if you want to know the instantaneous power at any moment in time, then that is the, we don't need the subscript for that, so the instantaneous power is dW by dt. So you have to take the derivative of the work function divided with respect to time. But there's another way you could figure this out, and this is where we can make a connection to something we did earlier in the earlier one of the earlier exercises. dW, the change in work, the small change in work, remember, is the a force, your force function, dotted into dr. So I can substitute in for dW f dot dr. And so or you could say that f dot dr is the same as the power times the change in time. But let's write it out this way. So dW is the force dotted into dr. And that is with respect to time. So this is the derivative of a product, which would require the product rule, which would say that the first times the derivative of the second, which I'm going to just take, we're doing the dot product, so I'm going to take the magnitude only now, plus the second times the derivative of the first. So that's f at r by dt times dr. If the force is not changing with time, which is the case for a lot of the different problems that you guys are going to be doing, or the problems that you'll see, then this term can go away. If f is constant. If it's constant over time, then the rate of change of the force over time is zero. And so you only then have to worry about this first term if it's constant. And so you get, you get here P equals F times, actually before, let me backtrack one step. If I want to take the dot product without using components, then I have to know an angle, because then if I want to, here I, this is, these are technically still vectors with this being the dot product between them. So let me say that, you know, this term doesn't matter because if f is constant, that becomes zero. Let me also then point out that dr by dt, that's just the velocity vector. So now I can rewrite this as f dotted into v. And so this is true for a force that is not changing with time. If you want to figure out the instantaneous power, you could do it this way. F, magnitude of F times the magnitude of V times the cosine of the angle between them. Or Fx Vx plus Fy Vy plus Fz Vz. That would be the other way that you can approach that situation. So, I mean, electricity is energy. So electrical forces use electrical energy to do work on electrical systems. So when you buy a light bulb and it's measured in watts, that is the power, because that's telling you the rate at which your appliance is using up energy per second. Now when you get billed for your electric bill, they usually charge you in kilowatt hours. This is a unit of energy or work, because this is power. Kilowatts is just 1,000 watts, and this is time. So that's either the change in work or the change in energy. Okay, I am going to leave it at that. We'll recap when we come back from break and review any of these concepts that you'd like to go over. And we'll finish out the marking period, talking a little bit more about potential energy and learning about a new type of graph called the potential energy curve. So, see you next time.